most welcome to visit this morning. You should have with you a hymn book, a green hymn book. The numbers are on here, the three numbers are here, and I shall announce them. And our third hymn you will find on a sheet of paper, all right, for later. And I'm just going to say this now, because most weeks I tend to forget it, that at the offertory, when we sing, be still, at that point, your collection will be taken up, and you're warmly encouraged to give as generously as you can. Thank you. So let us now find hymn number 467 from our green book and stand.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this,
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry.
Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As far as the east is from the west, so far has he set our sins from us. Page 4 in your service book, please.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Man of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, have overcome death and opened up to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that, but as by your grace going before us, you put into our minds good desires, so by your continual help we may bring them to good effect. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Would you like to be seated for the minute?
The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Genesis in the 22nd chapter, beginning at the first verse. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering, and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father Abraham, "Father," and he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar, on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham." And he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." As it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself have I sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this and not withheld your son, your only son, I will indeed bless you. And I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore, and your offspring shall possess the gate of their enemies, and by your offspring shall all the nations of the earth gain blessing for themselves, because you have obeyed my voice." This is the word of the Lord.
And they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of God.
Thank you. Thank you. We stand to sing our next hymn, number 114, number 114. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it better. bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown down into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done to you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our Old Testament reading this morning takes us back about 4,000 years in history and to that moment when God calls on Abraham to sacrifice his son, his only son, Isaac. In our second reading of the epistle, we heard that God is love. How is it possible that a God of love would call upon Abraham sacrifice his son? On reading that reading, one of the set readings for this Sunday, I could not but think of dear Francesco Lorenzo, the young boy who last weekend was out on his moped in Taormina and came into collision with another vehicle and tragically died, aged 22. There is no word in the English language for the pain of a parent losing a child. We have the word widow when we lose a spouse or widower, but the pain is so deep when a parent loses a child that no word would be adequate to explain what has happened. Francesco was an only child, I believe, just as Isaac, the son of Abraham, was an only child. Such grief. And I'm immediately reminded of what I shared with you on Easter Sunday, that in my own family, when I was growing up as a young boy in England, we had a death. A brother of mine, Philip, died, and a few years later, my older brother, Stephen, died aged 15. And the pain, really, that struck our family, that's now striking the family of Francesco, really never goes away. The pain is always there. And we're forced to ask, how could a loving God allow something like this to happen? For theologians, it's the great theodicy question. God is put on trial. Paul, the apostle, writing to the Corinthian church, speaks of the foolishness of God. And he goes on to say that the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom. But we ask, where is this wisdom for families when they are shattered by the death of a child? Let's go back to that scene in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, where Abraham is called upon by God to sacrifice his son Isaac. He gets up in the morning, packs the knife and the wood, and they set off for the lion. Isaac, the little boy, knows that there is to be a sacrifice made that day. He turns to his dad, Abraham, and says, good question to ask. Where is the lamb? Have you forgotten to bring the lamb with you? Abraham, his father, replies, God will provide. And then, as we heard in the reading, at the very last moment before the knife was going to plunge down into Isaac, suddenly an angel calls on him to freeze and to not do anything. And then a ram is found in a bush. God has provided the lamb, and in due course that ram is sacrificed on the altar. Isaac is spared. Great test of Abraham's faith. He was willing to let go of that which was most precious to him, his only son, Isaac. And that lamb that God provided is for us Christians, of course, the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, who takes away the sins of the world. Coming back to my own family, my father's name was Peter. And when our two brothers had died, my father effectively lost his faith. He'd been quite a devout Christian, really. And we never talked about it. It was a complete taboo for us as a family. And some years later, when I was had become a theology student, he asked me the question, how can God allow this to happen? How can God allow two of his sons to die? And then I said to my father, like a good theology student would, well, God, in giving up Jesus to die on the cross, demonstrated for us his love for the world. My father responded, well, that makes sense, and I understand that. I agree with that. And looking back at it, what I had said to him was, in a way, an appeal to his mind, an appeal to his intellect. Yes, God had sacrificed his son Jesus for him, and therefore he suffered the pain of losing the son for the father. It was an appeal to my father's intellect. Equally, to say that Jesus, the crucified one, has risen from the dead, and therefore we who follow in the footsteps of Jesus will one day rise from the dead. It's true. My father continued to believe that was true. But I suggest to you it was an appeal to his mind, his intellect, a statement he would agree with, but it did not deal with his pain and his grief, which continued till he died. And so we need wisdom, but we need a deeper wisdom to deal with our grief in such situations. And it's that I want to explore with you this morning through the lens of our gospel reading. For Jesus says to us, I am the vine and you are the branches. Our lives are mystically connected to the life of Jesus. We are organically connected to him as he is to us. At any moment in time, his life flows through us. Our life is connected to each other and to his. And I love this English word that's fallen out of use in the English language. To abide is much more than to remain, isn't it? Jesus says, abide in me, remain in me. Abide with me suggests a mutual indwelling that goes beyond words. Just come in and have a seat if you like. Venite pues. Venite. Benvenuti. Jesus says that outside the vine, which is him, outside the vine, there is really no life. And within the vine, those who abide in him as he abides in us. When one of us suffers, all of us feel the pain, because we're organically connected to each other. When one rejoices equally, all of us rejoice with that person. And reflecting on this, our gospel reading, I was reminded of an occasion when I was a vicar back in Kent some years ago, and I was to take an assembly in the local primary school. And I came up with the idea of taking a little grape pip along with me. So I took a grape pip along and explained to the children how all the DNA necessary for the production of grapes and vines was enclosed, encapsulated in this one tiny grape seed. Some months later, I went back to the school. And the head teacher came to me with a little pot with a little flower. She said, "The pupil who you gave that little pip to planted it in earth, and look what's happened. A little vine has begun to grow." And so I took this home to Margareta, my wife, and she planted it in earth. And then I was diagnosed with bowel cancer. Not a lot of fun when you just started work as a vicar. And for a year and a half I was away but being treated, not able to work. And Margaret faithfully watered this little sapling, this little emerging vine tree. And she carried on to watering it, and it grew gradually and gradually. Occasionally it would fade. It looked like it was going to die, and it didn't, and it grew again. And then I was healed. I'm still here. And that tree, then, when she planted it into the vicarage garden, it became a vine in the garden there, producing grapes. There's a wonderful verse that I love so much in the Psalms, where the psalmist writes, "Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy." Those who sow with tears reap with songs of joy. The tears that we shed when we lose a loved one drop down into the ground and become seeds. And that brings eventually new life. Francesco, who we're mourning, is a young boy. His parents decided, once they heard that he died, to donate his organs to medical research. And those organs of Francesco are going to live in another person, giving them sight perhaps, giving them a kidney or even a heart. Something of him lives on in that way, but there's much more than that. The pain, the grief of his parents remains, but I believe in the fullness of time, something good may yet come out of it. My parents lost two brothers when I was a child, but I know for certainty that I would not be standing here with you now if they had not died. We'll take another sermon to explain that. Something good can come out of a terrible disaster. God seems at the time to be foolish, even cruel. C.S. Lewis even describes him as a despotic God, a torturer. At the beginning, it often seems like that, but within the foolishness of God is hidden a much deeper wisdom, which appeals not so much to our intellects and minds, but to our hearts. The wisdom of belonging, the wisdom of sharing with each other, the wisdom of abiding in the vine which is Jesus. The Old Testament wisdom of old, earlier parts of the Old Testament, goes like this. Blessed are you when your children around you are like arrows within a quiver. The more you've got of them, the more blessed you are. But Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount turns this completely on his head, saying, you've heard that said, but I say to you, blessed are you who mourn, for you will be comforted. A deeper wisdom. Sowing with tears happens in the life of the community. When my second brother died, we were on holiday in France, having just crossed the English Channel. We'd been camping there for 2 weeks as he was languishing in hospital. And when we went back to put our tents down and go back home with the son missing, I shall never forget all the French women coming to us from across the campsite who'd been living this crisis with us and putting their arms around us and crying with us. We went back over the channel and everyone went cold. We Brits, perhaps, are not very good at helping each other more. Many, many years later, I was a vicar in Cranbrook, the same place I mentioned earlier, and I had never wept for my brothers. And one day I told the Romany girls, women, the local gypsies who I was working with, that the story of the loss of my brothers. And as I was telling them the story, they began to cry. And I found myself weeping too. Some years later, when I was a vicar in Luton and began working with the Eastern European Roma women, they taught me to speak their language, and I told them the story of my bereavements. And again, they began to weep as I explained it to them. And again, my tears were released. We have much to learn from communities like that. But I suggest to you that something changed within British culture at that moment, at that day when Princess Diana, Prince of Wales, died so tragically. There was there not a great outpouring of grief across the nation, perhaps such that had never happened before. Perhaps something was released in the community, the whole country, at that point. So you see, we Christians do not have a monopoly on grief. The edge of the vine, which is the life of the Jesus, the edge of the vine is not the walls of our church. There is no edge to the vine. The life of Jesus reaches out beyond the walls of our church. It's a vine that is spreading and growing all the time, reaching out to our seeds, where at this moment, no doubt, refugees are trying to cross from Africa to Italy. Reaches into Ukraine, reaches into Gaza. And the vine, which is the life of Jesus, which we abide in, is not limited by time or space. The life of the vine reaches to the corners of the earth and to from earth to heaven. Francesco is living now in heaven, still part of the vine. In a moment, we'll be remembering as we come to the altar how those grapes were crushed and became wine, and how we, when we receive in faith that wine, receive Jesus and abide in him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. find on page 6.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, which is only begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, but one being with the Father, through whom all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came out of man, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified and Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is richly glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us
Jesus, our exalted Lord, has been given all authority. Let us seek his intercession that our prayers may be effective by his prayer. Jesus Christ, great high priest, living forever to intercede for us, pray for the church, your broken body in the world. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, King of righteousness, enthroned at the right hand of the Majesty on high, pray for the world and make it subject to your gentle rule. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, Son of Man, drawing humanity into the life of God, pray for your sisters and brothers in need, distress or sorrow. Today we're especially praying for the parents of Francesco. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus, pioneer of our salvation, bring us to glory through your death and resurrection. Surround with your saints and angels, those who have died, trusting your promises. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, Lord over all things, ascended far above the heavens and filling the universe, pray for us who receive the gifts you give us for work in your service. Today we're especially praying for Anglican primates meeting right now in Rome. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Jesus Christ, keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at your feet. For you are alive and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Stand. The risen Lord Jesus came and stood in the midst of the disciples, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
and also with you.
We offer one another a sign of the peace. I haven't given myself a copy of the words in the next hymn, which you will find on the sheet of paper you can think of them through. Let us stand to sing this beautiful hymn.
Thank you.
wine set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh, and as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and was revealed and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And now we give you thanks, because by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us in him a new people to show forth your glory. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of the power and might, heaven and earth.
The same way after supper he took the cup and gave him thanks. He gave it to them saying, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Saint George and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray. praying with confidence as our Saviour has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Before we sing our final hymn, Margaret and I would love to thank you for having us here with you for these last 6 weeks, the whole of Holy Week and Easter, and the whole week really. It's been an absolute divine privilege and something to treasure forever, this opportunity to be with this community of St. George's in Taormina. To relish this unbelievably beautiful setting that you enjoy and have done for a century in this place. And it's going to be quite hard for us tomorrow morning to head off in the train to Rome in the noise and bustle of Rome. And we shall adapt to the other life, that kind of city life, and no doubt over time. But it has been an absolute privilege and honour for us to share with you. We feel quite attached to some of you as we've got to get to know you and enjoy greatly meeting every week new people from across the globe. That's been very special. And we do hope that the opportunity will might be there for us to return at some point, should there be the need. Thank you. Of course. Just before.
You pinched all my words.
Oh, did I? Oh.
Yes, you did. No, I just want to say thank you to Margaret for the lovely music. It is such a treat for us to have somebody play for us. Martin, we are so grateful to both of you for stepping in. We had a lovely Easter, we've had a lovely month, and I must say, I personally found your sermons very enlightening. And I do thank you for this. And we hope we come back sometime. And on a personal note, your photograph does not do you justice.
Oh. Thank you so much.
I have to ask you a personal recommendation to the office in London to say we want you back as
possible. Nice to get something right. Good. And we all, of course, as well as thanking Margaret for playing, thank as ever, as we have been doing for decades, Signor Salvatore, who faithfully acts as verger, rings the bell, and does all sorts of things, and his wife cleans the church. And we ti ringraziamo, Signore, dal cuore, dal cuore. And to take it to our heart. So, we need to sing another hymn, but there's just a little thing. I do have a library over here, it's wonderful. I'd like to contribute two books to it. It's me, two books that I wrote myself. One about work with the gypsies in Cranbrook, one about work with the gypsies in Luton on Eastern Europe.
Thank you.
Good. So, let's stand to our final hymn, number 3. 39, and afterwards you will be invited to the curriculum and coming to the outside here.
Amen.